You?
Hey everyone, welcome to our webinar today. It is going to be brought to you by Maggie Pfeifer, which is me.
And Brad Hall, who is me.
So I am the VP of Education here at the Eureka Ranch. So I work on all of our curriculum and develop the programming as well as teach and train the classes. And Brad does the same thing. He's on the team. He is master grader for all innovation courses and also works to help develop them and work on the curriculum. So we're going to bring to you today some lessons, really a behind the scenes look at what's new and what's been working since we started developing an online innovation engineering fundamentals course, which results in Blue Belt certification. So it's been about a year since we really hatched the idea, and we've come a long way. So we want to share that story with you as we go. So if you don't know much about the Eureka Ranch or the history of us, I just wanted to give you kind of a backdrop of who we are and what we do. So the kind of three things that the Eureka Ranch offers, number one, something we've been doing since our inception 35 years ago, is Eureka Inventing, where we find, filter, and fast track big ideas for teams, oftentimes from a big co. And then we have innovation engineering, which is the part where we teach you how to find, filter, and fast track big ideas. So obviously we've been developing systems over the years, and now we package them to explain to others exactly how they're done. And this helps by, you know, making people able and have the capabilities of doing these things over and over again. And then third, something we're not going to talk at all about today, but it is part of our umbrella, is we have a whiskey company out in our garage that makes award-winning whiskeys in about 40 minutes instead of 12 years. So if the Eureka inventing helps us roll up our sleeves and really walk the talk and do the innovation with and beside our clients, the innovation engineering component really teaches Amanda Fish, helps people get up and get enabled to do it for themselves. And then the brain brew stuff, we get to sort of practice what we preach, do some cool inventing, and take ideas and products straight to market. So today, we're going to focus on the innovation engineering part because we're talking all about courses and certification programs. So the ones that we currently offer today, and really have been offering for quite a few years now, is a fundamentals program where we learn, where you can learn and apply 12 fundamental skills to creating, communicating, and commercializing new ideas. It's for those people who want to work smarter and faster, no matter your job title or experience. This one results in a blue belt certification. We then have the mastery program, which is our full curriculum of 48 skills to learn the entire innovation engineering system. And this one's really for innovation specialists who want to teach. Innovation run sessions or really lead projects to disrupt your company or your industry, whatever it might be. That leads to black belt certification. And then finally, we have a leadership course, which is really about just learning the principles and the framework around systems-driven innovation. This one's for company leaders who want to lead and learn their role in enabling a culture of innovation. Today, we're going to talk about the story of how the fundamentals training course went online. Okay, so once upon a time, and actually, it still exists this way as well, but students came to us. We had physical classes, and we've been doing these for about 10 plus years. We have this wonderful facility in Newtown, Ohio, where people come, they learn, we give them a very dynamic learning experience, and it's something that we have really excelled at and sunk into over the past 10 years. And this is me, coaching a team. The best part about in-person trainings is that obviously you're building relationships in real time, you can see and people can ask questions in the moment, what people are getting, what they're not getting, you can course correct in real time, and there's just a lot of that satisfaction in seeing the light bulb moments go off. You can hear people report at the end of their days how it went, what did they learn. It's all very tactile, and we can sort of see the learning take place. So as we were thinking about, you know, stepping back and reanalyzing what is our mission as an organization, especially with innovation engineering, we had to remind ourselves about a year ago that our mission is to change the world through systems that enable innovation by everyone, every day, everywhere, resulting in innovation speed and decreased risk. So if really we wanted to reach everybody, it's not going to happen if everyone has to come to us, if everyone has to come to Newtown, Ohio, if I have to physically and personally coach you side by side. So that's when we really sort of examined, existentially, what kind of training programs do we want to offer? We were hesitant, though. We were late to the online game because we know that just putting up a lecture or a video series isn't going to lead to the retention and really the results and active, you know, engagement that we really wanted with teaching people how to do innovation and change, transform themselves and their culture. So we knew that we didn't just want to slap videos online. We also knew that we couldn't just take our existing programs and our existing trainings and just throw those up on the internet. It had to be different. We had to reinvent something. It had to be a total disruption to how we thought about teaching. So we really didn't know where to start, which is why we didn't for so long.
So that actually brings us to spring of last year, 2018, where we accepted that we had this issue and we needed to develop an online class. But before we went anywhere, I put a big hold on it because Maggie was on maternity leave and I didn't want to blow everything up while she was gone and just about to come back.
So of course, when I did come back, this was the new challenge. Okay, we've got to figure this out.
But we had a big death threat. So our issue with this and trying to create the online course was, will students have confidence to take action on innovation after taking this course? Which can kind of be broken down into two different metrics. Is can we get you functional with new tools and methods? And can we make the learning really stick? AKA, can we create a transformation and get you a new mindset going through this?
We know that with a transformation in how you think about opportunities and challenges that you face, it's that transformation that's going to stay with students beyond the tools, because tools change and methods change, and sometimes they have to be adapted or improvised upon. So it's that stickiness and the creating a transformation in how people think, how you think, is really what we were worried we couldn't accomplish through the online learning system.
So when Maggie got back, we came up with an idea to build an online class that uses Plan, Do, Study, Act as a framework to teach.
We thought if we could get the do and the reflective moments of the study and the action-oriented part of the act, like, this could give us a framework to accomplish our mission.
Then come the summer, we started creating some concept and functional prototypes, some very rough things that were ugly, but gave us an idea. Collect feedback and then we pushed to raise the learning that was happening in October, and they needed this course to attend it. In the winter, we kept debugging the technology and refining the assignment flow, really taking all the things we had learned and really making it a better course. And we actually re-recorded 100% of the video classes to make them more appropriate for the online course in this new method. In January, we had our version 1.0 launch to about 50 students, and we started building the support systems to help those students along, keeping up with them over the course of the course. In the spring now, it brings us to today, is we want to share it more broadly with everyone. And we got some new news for where we're going next at the end of this webinar for you.
So how did we go about addressing that death threat that was always in the back of our minds? So there's sort of four things I want to share with you, and within each, specific things that are in the class that kind of help us with both getting you functional with tools and helping a transformation of how you think. So the first one is about anytime, anywhere. So this is the ultimate benefit with an online class, right? You don't have to come to Newtown, Ohio. You don't have to get a plane and take 2 days off of work and get really behind in your schedule. So we're thinking about, you know, this anytime, anywhere benefit. And when we think about this for students, what we recommend, because it has to be coming, you know, from a place of self-motivation, and yet we want people to stay engaged with us across, you know, many skills over kind of a journey of your learning. So we recommend with students as they sign up is that they spend some time each day. Now, it doesn't have to be every day, it could be every other day, but it's sort of that constant embedding into the routine that is really going to help us stay engaged and keep those skills building upon one another. So we recommend about 30 minutes per day, and that means, you know, engaging in a little video class one day, spending some time on a lab assignment one day, chipping away at a personal project the next. So it's sort of like taking everything that we did and making sure that it was consumed or be able to be consumed in 30 minutes a day. So we have timers or suggested times in the online portal, which says, hey, take about 20 minutes to accomplish this for your first submission. This is something that we can highly gate or regulate in an in-person class, but in the online world, we wanted to give suggestions or nudges for kind of how long to spend on each thing so people didn't overthink it.
And so we also wanted to look at any time. So when are students working on this course? We pulled all the data because it's an online course. We have all the data of when they're doing things, when they're submitting work. And we actually found it's pretty even across the board. The weekends, it's a bit less people are doing work, but during the week, it's pretty consistent. They're all submitting the same amount of cycles. And during the day, it's pretty consistent across the morning, the afternoon, and the evening of when people are submitting. In fact, I've had assignments submitted at 2 a.m. multiple times, and I wake up to assignments to grade.
So really, people are working around the clock. The next factor in terms of time is that we're recommending, or we're giving folks about 6 months to complete the course.
So we're actually giving 6 months. If you actually look at all the time, if you spend 30 minutes a day, it's only about 3 months to complete the course. And we're actually finding that the average time to completion so far is about 2.5 months. But we give you 6 months because we know life happens. We know things go crazy. So you have that buffer time to make sure you have time to finish the course.
You also have access to the whole website and all the tools. So if you do finish early and you want to put everything you've been learning into practice or keep using the software, you do have some time to do that, to flesh out the 6 months. We're about 4 months into the class, and so far the people that started in that original January group of about 50, we are seeing 25% have almost or completed the course, and then you can sort of see from there the progression of folks throughout, and we're about 4 months in, like we said. So some folks are going to take this full 6 months, and that's perfectly fine, and others are just sort of working through it a little bit more quickly. The clock, however, doesn't start until you complete the first skill. So this is something we added later based on just the behavior that we were recognizing for folks, because this is the chart of people who have actually started, but it doesn't include those that haven't actually even gotten into the course yet. They've paid in January, but haven't taken the first step. You'll see here at the top, your due date or your course expiration doesn't begin until you complete the first module. We feel like getting started is the hardest part, because it's like, okay, I'm just putting it off, I'm putting it off. And so we actually have 20% of students who haven't even gotten off the starting block. But once you do start, over 75% of them have completed more than one skill. It's like rolling and they get into a momentum. So the second thing we're going to talk about here is freedom within a framework. So not just anytime, anywhere, but we want to also give students the choice to work on what they want to work on. So the first thing is, and you can see here on the left, is kind of a tree of how the course looks when you log in, so that students can work on kind of what they want. There's three main tracks. There's that create track for creating ideas, communicating ideas in the middle, and then commercializing or just making those ideas real. And so students can kind of work through whatever track that feels most relevant to them at the time.
And I've actually seen students as they're going through the class, some people go straight left to right, top to bottom. Some people jump around. I've seen people work just left to right and then go down left to right again. So it's really students are going where they want to go for it.
Second component to this is that you can't progress to deeper skills until you've mastered sort of the foundational ones. So the top tier there would be kind of those prerequisite classes that introduce the track, and then you can go down deeper into the advanced skills. So this is called competency-based learning. It just says, okay, I'm going to master part A before I go into part B. That's something too with in-person courses we can't achieve, because everyone's moving on the same clock. We've got to move to skill two. I don't care if you missed something in skill one, like we're all going forward. So that's the benefit of this, is people can kind of get fully understand before they move on to the next thing, because the program actually gates you off.
We've actually embedded this into the assignments as well. So when you're in a skill, you can't actually do the second assignment until you've completed the first. So we're really embedding it everywhere within the course.
And then the last set here is where you bring it all together. There's a couple systems skills, and this is where you do your final application project, where you put everything you've learned into real life and apply it to a project. So the third is really bringing relevance and repetition to the actual coursework. So the first thing is, we want to continue to connect assignments to real life. There has been this huge conversation, both in our on-campus courses as well as our business and executive courses, that we think the things we're teaching apply to business for sure, but they also apply to universal kind of life skills, creating ideas, communicating them. I mean, these are things that you do in your everyday life. So we want to keep connecting assignments to real life in that way. So we have a long way to go. We want to get even more, but currently we have 20% of our lab or practice assignments related to a personal thing or sort of a universal or agnostic topic. So we're trying to sort of cleanse it from just being a business or for-profit world course to really all things to the individual. And then 100%, of course, of your application project is on personal or real work based on sort of your own choice and whatever is relevant to you at the moment. This other thing that we want in terms of repetition and, getting a sort of self-awareness going is we have a self-assessment cycle, which is new. So students can check for common mistakes and fix them before they submit to an instructor. So there's this perform self-assessment button after every single lab assignment, which means you've got to take a look at some grading standards or grading guidelines that every instructor will sort of base their judgment of your work on. And these are the same grading guidelines that we give to faculty on college campuses or anyone that's teaching our executive courses. Is these are the things that they look for in your answers. So you can take a look at them right for yourself and just sort of correct quick things that you might have missed. You can edit and update. and sort of feel even more confident that you submit to your instructor so that we aren't sort of sending it back because you missed an instruction or something like that.
So even anecdotally looking at these, we also give this as students a way to just kind of get that quick first cycle, because in the in-person classes, we are finding the first time someone submits, it's just the little stuff that they didn't follow the instructions completely, that kind of thing. You don't want to waste time doing that when you have to wait for an instructor to get back to you. And having students go through this, I've actually found that the first submissions are much higher quality than I've tended to see in the online, in the in-person courses. We're actually finding, looking at the data, that the median time spent on the self-assessment cycle is about 5 minutes. But yeah, sometimes people are just blowing it off and clicking through, but on average, they're spending a decent amount of time looking at it and reflecting on their work.
And refining it and updating it. So last, we also built in, and this might have been an overbuild, but we built in a second example for every single lab assignment. So let's say you went through the lab, you did your self-assessment, and you still weren't confident, you can actually choose to practice again. A different example, a different case study, a whole different scenario. But sadly, only about 1% are taking advantage of this. I know it's sort of my common sense reason behind that would be it's just more work. But some people do find it useful to just take a path and see a new incarnation of the skill.
Also just a way that if they don't want to wait for feedback, if they have extra time and want to practice it, they can, but they're not yet.
So the last thing is really a difference or an enhancement to our feedback and coaching tactics. So the first thing with an online class that we wanted to do was make an immediate connection from day one. So folks get an email from me as soon as they register for the course, and it gives an introduction not only to the course, but to me personally, and also asks a student to say, hey, who are you and why are you taking this class? So we get written responses back that just sort of says, here is who I am and why I signed up. So here's just a couple of responses to that. So I want to learn how to better identify the best ideas, make them real to actually make a positive difference in our community. I want to learn how effectively put in systems, a systems model for innovation to create ideas for meaningful, unique learning experiences for our students, someone who's teaching or in academia. I am taking this course to improve my critical thinking processes and to find creative ways to be creative. My anticipated outcomes for this course are to develop and expand the skills and IE process in my life, having a greater impact on my family, friends, and work. I'm hoping to learn more effective methods to get new pertinent products to market quickly, and also how I can communicate these strategies to a team and rekindle some lost energy. So you can see people coming at this from different places, but it also helps us know, okay, what is in it for you, so that we can start to tailor our feedback or really help you succeed in your own personal mission with the course. Okay, the second thing is more feedback than the in-person class, both positive and the things that we can encourage you to do. So a traditional course, if you've ever taken one from us, there is an online component where you submit homework, and this is an example of what you might get back from Brad, who's grading an assignment, kind of quick and to the point.
And this is just kind of a result of the type of course. You are grading in the course, you have however many people are there, and then all of a sudden all these assignments come in, and you want to get them back to the students so they can start looking at them. You can't spend a ton of time on each assignment when you have 20, 30 assignments to grade.
And we get to do a one-on-one coaching in the in-person, so there isn't as much, like, we can sort of catch people in real time, so a lot of it comes verbally. In the online course, it doesn't happen that way, and we have to give both positive enforcement of, like, what went right, as well as, okay, here's some things you can do better. So the online course, the instructor feedback looks a little bit different. It's a much wider box so that we can write in more things and actually kind of start that conversation. So it's much more conversational. We actually found over analyzing most of the boxes that we're giving twice as much written feedback, and it starts that conversation again and builds a relationship between the two.
It's really about a combination of that coach that would be in your group course correcting, as well as the grader who's marking things wrong and right. So it's really the combination of the two.
So the last thing too, what matters to us in terms of getting people their feedback, is the response time. So when we set up this class, we said, okay, we got to guarantee a day, 24 hours, you're going to get your feedback, because we don't want to hold you up if you're going to try to take this class on your own time. So we've really excelled or really crushed this. So the median response time has so far been 2 hours. And actually 70% of students are gonna get their assignments back in less than 9 hours. So we are delivering on that promise, and we think it makes a big difference when students submit and they get that feedback right away, they can just progress farther. Because we said earlier, you can't go past the skill you're on unless you get your feedback that you've done it well and that you've completed it successfully. So this matters.
And actually, one of the things we built into the course, yeah, you have to complete a skill to go on to the next skill, but in those three tracks, you can work on all three tracks at the same time. And we thought maybe people will work on multiple ones so they don't have to wait for feedback. And sometimes that's happening, but for the most part, people are just sticking with one skill at a time. So really keeping that response time down is helping so that they can keep progressing through the course.
Okay. So the last thing that happens is as soon as we give feedback, they do get an email, and the entire feedback blurb is embedded in that email. So you don't have to wait to see what the positive or negative feedback was. You don't even have to go back into the class. You can kind of take a quick glance at it, and you can see what we had to say. So over the course of anyone's journey for completing this entire course, you're going to get about 35 graded cycles back from us. And that, of course, depends on how many you fail or how many you pass the first time. That's been an average so far. And so this is just an unprovoked sentiment that came in from someone related to the feedback and how it's been meaningful. So they say, first of all, it's probably one of the hardest, the most challenging courses I've ever taken online, and it has been the most rewarding. Brad has given me such insightful comments on how I can improve my assignments that it has made the challenges even more worthwhile. So it is the constant feedback, course correcting that we have achieved in the personal trainings. We're achieving it in the online trainings as well, which is a big win.
It's really seeing time and time again when students reach out with a question, when they're frustrated on an assignment or stuck in something, they really start to excel at that point and they start to reach out more and more. I keep getting more emails, hey, I'm not sure on this thing, how can you help me? And once they open that dialogue, they really start looking for more help and really progressing better and doing better in the course.
So that brings us to the last point, which is just more support in general. So in terms of email support, when your assignment's been graded, like you saw, you get the email. We also send out monthly nudges and even examples of some assignments that are complete once per month so that students just remember that they're taking this class. And if they're stuck, we say, hey, here's an example of a really well-written idea or yellow card. So it could help them get off of the hurdle. And then finally, there's on-demand support. Like Brad said, people can email us anytime, and we're usually quite responsive. So they could email, they could also do support chat. We now have it for both content and technical questions, so there should never be a hesitancy to reach out if you're stuck, and people do use that quite a bit. And then finally, after certification, we always offer to have a phone call so that we can help you connect the dots with what do you want to do next. How are you planning on implementing and using your new skills back at home? And so we do about an hour phone call if you want to, which is just personal and custom and, you know, helping you really make this meta into your life. So now, what do we think about this death threat? We wanted to do two things. We wanted to overcome these issues. Can we get you functional fast with new tools? And can we make the learning really stick? Now, all those different things we put in place to help us achieve this. Now, it's hard to know if we are ever really getting here, but the best way to tell is that in every cycle, we ask students to step back and reflect on what they've been learning, any aha moments, and especially too, at the end of the course, we ask the same question. So the best proof I have to say if we're making progress on these two things are straight from the words of the students. So I want to share with you a couple of things related to that. So the learning outcomes that we hope students get are related to those things, which is, can you create ideas? Can you communicate ideas? Can you commercialize ideas using the tools that we provide, that we teach you? Also, can you think better using writing and math, you know, which sort of gets to that transformation of mindset? These are the things that we promise going into the course. So here's what we're seeing coming out from people as they reflect on either one specific assignment or tool. And so here's some of the things we're seeing. The blue and yellow cards are great tools. I'm excited to use them in my projects going forward because they're really going to give me the boundaries to play within and help me from going on tangents. I think I'm going to make a slideshow to walk people through the blue card and also the yellow card and do this in a room together. We are all focused on working in the business, and this helps us work on the business. I think the 20 questions tool is amazing. At first, I felt like these were intimidating, but you can see here that they are essential to organizing thought. I was blown away with stimulus mapping. I have done mind maps before, but this system works so well for me. I love PDSA. Personally, I've been doing PDSA with a little less, being shallow thinking. Now I'll put more depth into my thinking. It was pretty easy to get two PDSA cycles into test theories. The study part of the thinking really helps you come up with new hypotheses to test. So we're thinking on the tools front. That's great. It's giving us some indication that people are making traction.
So then the second one is, can we create that transformation of mindset, which is the thing we were really concerned about? And the same thing from students. We have, I wish you could see the smile on my face. This is because going through this process made me think differently, and that is what I need to do in order to grow my business. I now know that I was really describing a type of innovation. This class taught me an entirely new perspective. I guess that the majority of students of this program come at it from a business angle. But when you think about it, there's so much to learn and apply from this course on a personal level. In my personal relationships and interactions with people on a daily basis, I can use this mindset of learning and building upon bits and pieces of stimulus I come across. In a sense, we are all trained to seek the correct answer on the first try. This course changed this mindset for me. In order to learn, grow, seek clarity, and drive down risk, we don't necessarily have to be right all the time, as long as we learn from missteps and adjust accordingly. Now it's time to start influencing my sphere with IE.
So, will students have confidence to take action on innovation? This is one more indication of proof to resolve this death threat, is the actual things that the students are working on with their application project. Because built into this class, this whole sequence of things where you're applying everything to your business, we looked at, what are people actually doing? So here's some examples. They're creating a curriculum design and development system to reduce turnaround time and be a leader in their industry. Improving the company's patent program to make it successful in establishing a new patent portfolio. They're creating a sustainability program to reduce waste and demonstrate their commitment to sustainability. They're looking at ways to expand capacity for an existing product line, and they're creating new marketing systems for existing services. So this is sort of the tangible things people are working on while they're getting their certification. So to us, as we're getting indication of all these things, and we are like, by all means, delighted and surprised at the results of the online class. I think all of us were a little scared and hesitant from the whole process, but what we're seeing back gives us confidence that that death threat is totally mitigated for now. We have dissolved it, and there are other things we want to work on, but that one, we know we can make an impact on folks when they're engaged and they're staying with us in the course. So that's not it. As you know us, we're constantly learning, we're constantly making adaptions and adjustments. So a couple of things coming next, and I could use your help on. These are things that we're actively thinking about. So we do need ideas for community building. We tried a Facebook group with the first 30 or so folks, and we got mixed results in terms of people even using Facebook. We also didn't fully commit, totally admit it. We didn't nurture the community. People are on there, they introduce themselves, but I think that to really make that work, we have to do a much bigger job of stoking the flame. So we have questions for you. How might we foster a more connected community of online learners? And what forum are people most comfortable with things like this? Is it Facebook? Can we try a different tool like LinkedIn, our collaboration cafe, maybe even a text app or a Slack channel? We're just looking for ideas, and we're open to everything in terms of building that community, because I do think that once you go through the course, having other people that are like-minded and share a common language can be a super valuable thing. Next, with an online course, when you're taking it by yourself, we're looking for ways to better leverage diversity. So core to our training is that meaningfully unique ideas come from exploring stimulus, leveraging diversity, and minimizing fear, but that diversity piece is a pretty important part. So we're thinking, how can we help students to engage others in their coursework without creating a delay or barrier? So how can we encourage people to like get with a team or use some of these tools with others without that being too intimidating or just causing delays? And then maybe an idea for this would be, how could interacting with a defined cohort enhance the experience or the opportunity for leveraging diversity? Maybe you go through it with everyone that's signing up at the, you know, this quarter or something like that, so that you can actually interact with the people taking the course. So we're exploring some of those ideas. Things that we're closer on in terms of what's coming next is, we are close to enabling full mobile capabilities with this. We are currently all set with a tablet. If you turn it to the side, it works really well. But we are making strides to getting it to work on your phone as well, so that the experience is really smooth from every device. And then the other thing we're trying to learn more about is helping people go faster. So things that might slow you down are committing to the whole package. It might be waiting on our feedback, different things like that. So currently, we have a certification package which takes you through video courses, lab assignments, like we talked self-assessments, and then you get tons of feedback on your application work. We're going to test and launch today with all of you and to the world a self-guided class that just contains the video lessons, the practice assignments, and the self-assessments so that we can experiment with people kind of running on their own time without waiting on feedback. They can also kind of consume the whole class at once, and then they can have an option to continue on for certification where they're adding in the feedback and they're sort of getting more rounds of advice once they get the practice down. So we're going to experiment with this. We are currently offering the full package at $1,500 for the whole summer, I think until the end of August. And we're going to experiment offering just a self-guided class for $500. And we're going to have those available on the website later this week. So these are some of the learnings we had this year. It's been a long year of, you know, evolving. We've come so far. And now we are really confident. And we're all so proud of this product that I'm glad that we could share it with you all. Thank you so much for listening. If you want to hang on, we are going to do kind of a live Q&A. And we're happy to answer any questions or go as long as you all would like. Thanks for hanging out with us guys today, and hope you took away some of the awesome things that we're trying and learning with our online course. Okay, gang. So Brad and Maggie here. If anyone wants to hang on the line, we are just open and ready to have kind of a dialogue, a discussion, and answer any questions that should arise. So feel free to chat in the chat window if you'd like. And we'll just sort of play off of that for now if any questions come up. We have some folks saying, thank you. You're totally welcome. Thanks for tuning in.
The online course really is a lot of fun. We've been doing the in-person for a while, and it's really different and interesting to grade it and help people through it.
The question came up, can I work on my product while going through the course? And the answer is yes. So the way it's designed is that the first pass through every skill, we give you a practice assignment. And then the second time you take the skill is related to your own product or your own project that you're working on. So you get a chance to practice with kind of a stock example, and then you can apply it right to what you're working on. The good news about that is once you apply it to what you're working on, we will give you feedback to your exact real work and your real project.
That feedback actually tends to differ a bit too. On the practice assignments, it's really looking at what are the specifics that you're doing, how to kind of like twist it and make it the best you possibly can be. Whereas with those applications in your real world, it's what's the more of a coaching approach and how can it help you just make it better in general?
So the next question is, how do I sign up? So we're going to send you guys a follow-up to this with just information about how to get going. We're actually also going to do with this group, a test drive. So if you want to go in and take the first skill, which is what is an innovation, you can take it, you can go through the whole module, we'll give you feedback on your responses, and then you can decide if it's something that you want to continue on, but at least you'll get a feel for how the class works. So stay tuned, we're going to send that out via email, and then probably at the same time we'll publish it on our website as well, so that just related to this webinar, and then you can take the test drive. So stay tuned for that. Other question is, so does the course work independently, meaning?
So does it work independently of other students in the class? And this was actually one of my design, like when we were building the course, that I really like pushed and emphasized on, was that you can take this course without talking to anyone but me for feedback and stuff. So you can do it totally independently, totally by yourself. Every assignment is designed to work that way. There's some assignments that are better if you get other people to do a mind map or something like that, but you can do it individually the whole way through.
So, the question about how does, has anyone gone through this class and then gone on to the mastery class? Curious about the feeling of readiness. So what was so interesting is when we did those pioneers last year to go into the fall class, that was our big question, is most of the time we got to see people for a personal fundamentals class before they reached mastery. And the two people that came from the online class in some ways were we're just as or more prepared. And the reason I say that is because I think sometimes in our in-person class, we go really fast. And at the online class, people are taking kind of the time to master what we talked about, competency-based, master each skill before they go on to the next one. So in some ways, I thought that the two online students had a more thoughtful or deeper interaction with us the first time than even the in-person students. So, I mean, that was just my opinion.
And they actually, so we talked to them about this because we were wondering it too, and they actually had different opinions. So we thought they were prepared, they did well. But one person loved it. He thought he wouldn't have done as well in the in-person class, but he actually liked the in-person for the mastery. And the other person felt the in-person was better because they were more wanting to work with that group, getting the feedback from the coaching right there.
Right.
It depends on the person too. Yeah.
So the next question is, how do you expect this to work or interact with the university program? So that's a really good question. We are right now, probably in the fall, gonna test at a few universities with a couple of sections, the same course, the same program. And then in, we hope to by 2020, in the fall of that year, be ready to kind of release it with all of our other offerings for universities. So we just have to make sure it has the rigor for college credit that our current courses do. And that might mean putting in a few extra lab assignments or things like that. So we are sort of working towards getting this qualified for credit on the campuses that are currently teaching our programs. How many passes can one learner take for improving the skills learned? There's no limit. So if it takes you 100 cycles to really get something, we're going to go 100 cycles with you. Typically, though, the average...
Average is probably 2 or 3 cycles if people need to work on them. Some go longer, but on average, that's where it is.
What we found is if it's the third cycle and we're not clicking with a certain example, what we're trying to do is then take people to the second example and say, okay, let's just wipe the slate clean. And let's start you on a new example, because I think maybe, you know, this one we're maybe getting stuck on whether it's maybe that particular topic or the feedback isn't working. So we just sort of hop ship and we say, okay, let's do it again with a different example. And this time maybe we can try to get you there a little faster. Can you do the $500 course and then add the $1,000 for the complete set? That's what we're playing with. So we're hoping that the $500 might give people a sampling, or, you know, I'm going to cut my teeth with it and then I want to get the coach to do my application project. So we're trying to give people a step up to that. And it may not be $1,000. We're trying to figure out what the pricing is. Maybe more, maybe less. It's probably going to be equivalent to or less than the full package, or we're going to figure that out. But there is going to be an on-ramp to full certification. Is there more system-related examples, activities in the online version than the in-person? We are definitely working towards that. I think we put in place, like I said, we have...
there is more.
20% now that are like personal-based and or universal. I would say we incorporated more of a spectrum of product and service and systems or sort of internal stuff. We are... getting there. We are trying to make that work. Sometimes a really easy thing to do is, like, for an idea to write it up, is to show you a picture of something and then you write up the idea. So we're trying to find more and more ways to do processes versus always just its or products, and have that happen fast. So I feel like that's always what we're trying to juggle, is the speed of learning with the content area.
So we got a question. With any online course, there's the issue of motivation. What ideas have you explored related to gamification? I'm thinking about, for example, unlocking something when you complete a skill, like being able to see how other people answered the assignment. This is actually something that we're really working on right now, because, I mean, it comes up. We've had some people who get jammed at work and they can't work on the course for a couple months and they struggle and that kind of thing. So it's something that we're really looking into right now. How can we help people stay motivated through the course and working through it? Gamification is a really interesting idea. It's definitely something that I think has to be done right. So thank you for the suggestion.
Yeah.
We're going to be looking into it for sure.
So another suggestion, can we customize the training to fit my product or my needs? I don't need to learn how to create ideas. So one thing that just came up in the last few weeks is actually trying to take apart the class. So, and if this is something that would be interesting to you, definitely let us know. But trying to take apart the tracks and saying, if you just want the commercialized track or the communicate track,
maybe selling them or offering them independently, and then you can kind of bundle them together if you want the whole deal. The thing with that is that they're so interrelated that we know that sometimes when you get stuck in even just commercializing ideas, you need to use the create tools to push past a boundary. So we kind of see them as really all parts of the same effort going, taking any ideas to life is like, you're always creating solutions to problems. So we see them so integrated, but we do recognize that maybe you just don't need that right now. So we want to see if the track by track could also be something that's meaningful to people and separating them out.
We got a couple questions here about using it as a way to like a refresher for people who have come through before. And especially the ungraded version of the course that we're just announcing today is a great way to do that. We haven't thought about it directly as a way to refresh, but that's definitely, I mean, it's something you can go through on your own time. It gives you the grading standards so you can look at it, and it would be a great way to.
Plus, all the videos are new as of January, so it is even sort of the same skills and principles that you remember, but it might be even a fresh take or fresh language based on kind of where we are now. Anything else coming through?
So we got someone here from who I believe is a current student actually in the online course. Have you considered adding a phone a friend option when working on a lesson? Sometimes I get stuck and it would be helpful for some live assistance. I understand that would take some resources, but it would be nice.
So, I mean, I'll say something in the support chat. If you say, can I get on a call with someone? Most likely, like, we're sitting right there at the support chat and we would be happy to take it from a message to a phone call. I'll just sort of offer that up. So for this person who's on the online class, try that next time, because that can maybe get you somewhere faster than waiting on an email response or something like that. So pop open the support chat and say, anyone available for a quick call? Chances are we probably will be.
Yeah. And that support chat, we added the option because of this course, actually, that for a content question, because it used to be that it would go to our IT department. They would then bring us in to answer the question. It would just take some time to do that. So now we have one that just directly goes to Maggie and I, so we can get on those questions faster when content questions come up. But like she said, if you want to talk, send in a support chat and let us know. Happy to talk.
Can you pay for the class over time? So this is a great question. And so what we really want to do is put in installments. I don't think we're activated, but it's so easy for us to do that. So the answer is yes, and we'll put it up when we send out this email, that you can either pay in one lump sum or try to figure out a 3-part or 4-part payment plan. And we've been talking about that. So thank you for that suggestion.
I think that's everything I have.
Okay. Great. So if you tuned in today, and even if you know...
Just the point, the person who's taking the course said they love the class. So that there's another example of someone like it.
Thank you for that too. So if you... register today. If you know someone who you want to hear the content or send the content to, we are going to send you guys a complete recording of today's webinar, and that'll be available probably today or tomorrow. So thanks for hanging out with us. Thanks for all your questions and feedback, and we will see you guys through online supports, emails, and everything else. Have a good rest of your week, you guys. Thanks a lot.